Recording has started.
ये दो ने
उधर मावे है ना ने ये वाके स्टीक ही कर क्योंकि मावे है ना ने यहाँ टेस्टिंग
ने ओके डांस बोल
आरे चेक कर अपने कंटिन्यू करते हो
अरे मैं मेरे माइक को अनम्यूट की ना अनम्यूट की ना माइक को
एक बार डाउनलोड करने पड़ा है ना यार एक
टेस्टिंग टेस्टिंग 1 2 3 टेस्टिंग 1 2 3 नहीं मेरे प्लग के गाल नहीं ना मैं
पापा बेटी चार्जर में बैठना होगा
प्रेजेंटेशन
वेबसाइट लिंक ओके आई थिंक
Good afternoon, everyone who is joining this investor presentation. This is in addition to the quarterly webinars that we do to update our investors. We thought of it is appropriate that we do this investor presentation to the investor community, especially at a time that we have already announced the rights issue and also the private placement. Extra general meeting, AGM, both are coming on 9th of April. So prior to that, we thought of keeping you all informed about the bank's growth story and also what we are going to do with the funds. So this presentation is mainly to address that. And thereafter, we'll have time to have a question and answer session. So this is about a In one glance, where NDB is today. 41 years in operations. We started as a development bank. Later on, we converted to a fully fledged commercial bank somewhere in 2005, when the country upgraded to the middle income category. So with the drying up of the funding lines and all, there was a need for us to go for commercial banking. So in that way, I think we are one of the youngest commercial bank operating in Sri Lanka. We have basically made quite a good progress over the last 4 or 5 years. And now we are the fourth largest commercial bank. We have 113 branches, over 3,000 staff. And the other advantage is we are the only financial services conglomerate with subsidiaries in investment banking, wealth management, and also stockbroking. All these entities are also leaders, especially the investment banking and wealth management side, and also stockbroking arm also within the top 5 or 6 stockbroking arms in the country. Other thing is we are the only EDGE certified corporate. EDGE stands for Economic Dividend for Gender Equality, and that's where about 40% of our staff are female, about 35% of them are at the senior management level. Equal opportunity, so gender equality is one of the key things that we do pay a lot of attention to. In the implementation of digital to ensure our sustainable cost savings are there, we have made very good progress. More than 15 robotic process automations that we have introduced, which basically have helped us to reduce a lot of sustainable savings on the cost side. Plus workflows and all that, we have been driving the digital drive even internally to ensure we get the best cost advantage, and then made much advances in the technology. We have invested in new core banking system, digital layer and all. Probably later on I will explain that more, but this is in a snapshot where we are today. And all our progress at the last year 2020, despite challenges, we have done very well. MDs have been recognized by a bank being named the best bank by the Banker magazine in December last year. And then a few weeks ago, again, this was confirmed by Global Finance of USA as the best bank in Sri Lanka. So I think it's a very rare opportunity, a bank being recognized by both these high caliber awarding bodies, the Banker and the Global Finance. In addition, the Asia Money has also rated us as best digital bank. That was announced only last week, so that I think there's some more publicity given from tomorrow. And then our investment banking also for the 8th consecutive time, I think we were awarded as the best investment banking company. Like that, several awards. So I think that's whenever you are doing well, naturally these awards also are a recognition of what we are doing. And that also helps and motivates our staff to do more to improve our service to the customers. So we just came up with a 5-year strategy, basically positioning NDB as the banking group to be bank with, and also with a 1 trillion asset base to have by 2025 from current level of 600 billion. This is in a snapshot how the NDB has performed over the last 4 to 5 years. You would note that we have been growing above the market average, the total assets, CAGR of 17% from around 380 billion in 2016. And over the last 4 years, we have grown up to 632 billion by 2020. This is partly thanks to the Transformation 2020 strategy that we introduced in 2018. And along with that, there was a target to achieve quite a rapid growth to be one of the top 5 banks. And I think that we achieved before 2020 itself. I think by late 2019, we achieved that target. And since then, we have continued that growth momentum. Net interest income, again, CAGR of 19%, in line with the asset growth of 17%. The net interest income 19%. That also shows that the NIM is CAGR is higher than the asset growth. That also shows that we have been working on the NIM as a figure. So as a result, CAGR of 19%. Gross loans and advances, again, quite a good story. We had 25% CAGR in deposits from a low base of around 200 billion in 2016. And over the 4 years, we have actually doubled that to have a CAGR of 25%, the deposits of 490 billion by December 2020. I think this is the highest cumulative average growth rate maintained by any bank in Sri Lanka for deposits. So is the loans, again, 18% growth in loans to cross 450 billion by December 2020. And not only the balance sheet growth, we have been quite committed to ensure that the profitability also is managed. So again, you would see that profitability, operating profit and net profit, both cumulative average growth rate of 17. So I think all these elements, average 17 to 20% kind of growth that the bank has made over the last 4 to 5 years. And as I mentioned, we are one of the fastest growing bank in Sri Lanka. The gross loan group, this is a comparison between some of the peers and NDB, peer comparison in orange and then the NDB in red. Here the peers also we are considered commercial bank, Sampath Bank, HNB, Ceylon, DFCC and NTB. Some of them are much larger in terms of the scale. So when you compare with those peers, naturally you would see our performance is much better than all these peers. And then even if it comes to the NPLs or the credit quality, again, better than the peer credit quality, which is reflected through the NPL ratio. They are again below the peer group, 5.4% for NDB versus 5.8% the average of the peer group NPL. If you look at the lending portfolio, again, quite a well-diversified book. I mean, except the pie chart shows that I think all these key business elements, the wholesale banking, retail banking, project finance, and SME are very equally distributed. So that's the other beauty. We are not relying on any particular area now. That was the case some time back, but we have been doing that to ensure that it's all coming from quite a good spread. And another area that NDB has consciously worked on is the deposit side. So as I said, we are a young commercial bank, 15 years old. So naturally, if you look at the branch network, more than 50% of the branches are less than 5 or 6 years old. So any bank, any branch to get their optimum results, you need to have established yourself in that particular town for 4 or 5 years to get the optimum. And this is where a hidden asset that NDB is having, and that is what we have been working on to ensure the liability focus is there. And that is typically coming out from a development banking mindset to come and grow the liability base. Our advance to deposit ratio in 2016 was somewhere around 115%. Now it has come down to 90.5%. So that also shows that we have been focusing much on the liability side, the deposit side, to ensure that our funding base is addressed more through the deposits. And now we are in line with the peer situation. There was a big gap between the peers and us earlier. Over the last 4 years, we have basically managed to be in line with the peers. And that has helped us to also ensure our own funding and also to bring down cost of funds down. Deposit growth is what I said earlier, clearly above the deposit growth rate compared to the peers, banks. Of course, 2020, naturally, I think there is the figure almost similar to the peer banks, naturally because of lower lending opportunities in 2020 with the COVID situation, but then there was quite a big liability excess funds that retain within the banking sector. Another good story is the CASA base, current and savings account, that has helped us to improve on our quality of the deposits. So they are again above the peers in terms of the CASA base growth. As of 2020, 52% of our deposits have come in CASA. So that also shows that the focus that we have made on getting the retail network to give this granular CASA, that I said, all these are granular CASA, that's an advantage. And then the next one is basically how we have moved away from some of the high cost borrowings. By 2020, the borrowings have come down, and then we are funding our book more through deposits, which is reflected in the better margins. And this is on the profitability and shareholder returns. Again, one area that we have been focusing hard was the contribution coming from fee income compared to the net interest income. And at the first time, after many years, compared to the peers, our fee income is higher than the peer as a percentage of NII. Ours is 24%, the peer is 21.9 or 22%. So the first time we have overtaken the peers in the fee income side as well in 2020. And profit after tax, again, always we have maintained above the peer group, and then clear growth in 2020. NDB had 8% growth in profit after tax. The peer, it was a negative 7.2% growth. But we have been maintaining this above the peer group. And we are the only bank among the peer groups with the assets in excess of 500 billion to achieve profit after tax growth in 2020. And this is again a story that we have been focusing very hard, and it's a good story where cost income ratio, the efficiencies as measured in cost income ratio, we have done well. 37% cost income ratio. You would note that somewhere around 2017, NDB's cost income ratio was at 45%. Peer level was around 43%. And consciously, we have been bringing it down every year. And now it is at 37%. It's all through a conscious approach on cost and also bringing efficiencies into way we work. So we have been introducing various workflows to ensure the operations are more streamlined. Then, as I mentioned, the robotic processors, all that has helped to ensure that our cost management is at optimum level. So though in terms of scale, we may not have the advantage of a larger bank scale that helps to bring the cost income ratio down, As a mid-sized bank, growing mid-sized bank, 37%, despite all that growth, I would have noted that I think one can achieve cost income ratio without doing much on all fronts. But here, we are invested in digital layers, we invested in new core banking, branch upgrades, the outer appearance, even the branding profile, all that. Whilst having all that, we have achieved 37% cost income ratio. I think that speaks volumes about the efficiencies that we have built up within the NDP landscape. And this, just to stir some interesting slides about the positive indicators that NDB compared to peers that we have performed. First one is on return on assets. Very consecutive growth from 1.5 to around 2 by 2019. However, 2020, all the banks had a drop in ROA, but there again, compared to the peers, we are above the peer ROA level. In 2017, the peer ROA was above us, but since then, with the 2020 transformation, 2020 strategy in place, and with consciously working on the margins and all, we have been doing much better than the industry. Even the ROE, much ahead of the rest. Again, we changed that in 2017. At the mid of 2018, we changed that and we have overtaken the peers in terms of ROE side. Again, somewhere around 16%, and then we are maintaining above the industry in terms of ROE. And NIM, there again, we have been narrowing the gap of NIM. In 2017, when it started, I think NIM was around 2.8%, and we have been gradually bringing that up and narrowing the gap between the peer NIM and us to ensure that sufficient NIMs are maintained. Apart from the net interest margin, we have been working on the fee side that has helped. As I explained earlier, the fee income side, that has also helped to get the ROE and the returns up. And the other one is on the dividends, the final dividends. Of course, 2020, we are yet to declare a final dividend, but we declared a cash dividend. But you would note that over the years, our cash component was reducing, but more on scrip dividend. That was for a reason, because relatively our capital ratios were lower than the peers. So that is what is getting addressed in the upcoming rights issue. So with that, we are comfortable that we should work on more cash dividend whilst keeping the dividend policy as is. This is an interesting slide, basically giving a snapshot of all the comparator banks, the peer banks that we spoke of, and how NDB in the first column, how we have performed compared to the peers. And there again, and the last column is our ranking in each category. So for example, total assets, NDB had 18% growth in total assets. We are the number two in terms of the ranking. Total loans, again, number two in terms of ranking. We had 8.4% growth. Deposits, 21% growth. Number three, there are NII, 0.2% growth. Still number three, because most of the other banks have shown negative growth there. Operating profit, again, number three. The most of the others had significant negative numbers there. And profit after tax, again, 8.2% positive when the larger players have shown negative growth impact. ROEs, I think it's number one, 13.1%. Of course, part of that is due to a lower capital base, relatively lower capital base. But ROA, that is number two, 1.6. One bank is just 10 basis points above us, but it's 1.6. Cost income ratio, this is again number two. Now, the larger banks, which have a bigger scale than us, almost two or two and a half times bigger than us, where the scale advantage is, compared to them, I think we have done well to become the number two in terms of cost income ratio. And NPLs, again, number three there. Now, this is the area that we are addressing both tier one and tier two. You would note that tier one, of course, the regulatory minimum is 8%. We are at 9.2%. But when you compare with the peer banks, we are lower than that. So that is getting addressed in the rights issue and the private placement. And tier two level, again, number six, about 200 basis points lower than some of the peers. So that is what is getting addressed again in the rights issue. Now, this is on the investor metrics, the price to book value. All the banks are trading much lower than the book value, but we are one of the lowest here, which should get addressed, 40% of the book value, price earning ratio of 3.7. I think more importantly, the return on market value on equity. Now, that's where we are much better than the peers. Now, this is earnings per share divided by market price. So since the market price is 40% of the net book value and trading currently around 80 rupees, earnings per share divided by market price, that gives a higher return on market value of equity. So this is something I'm sure the investors would be interested in. Among the peer banks, the highest in terms of return on market value on equity. And now that's about the performance so far. And then coming to the rights issue, which was announced. The size of the rights issue is 8 billion rupees, price at 75 rupees per share. So this price to book value of 0.36. And the share issue ratio is 28 rights for 61 shares held. And number of shares to be issued is 106.7 million. And naturally, the purpose of the issuance is to strengthen the capital base, improve on the capital ratio so that we can continue our growth story without tapping the capital markets again for a few years. I would say next four, 5 years. So that is the idea of raising this capital, which was announced at the latter part of last year. So the pre-capital adequacy ratios that we shared earlier, it is 9.2% for core capital and total capital at 14.3%. Now, with the post-rights issue, this is expected to go up to 11%, the 9.2% going up to 11%, and the total capital ratio from 14.3% to 16.1%. So this is assuming full subscription of 8 billion shares by the existing shareholders. In case there's good appetite, I think that's the indications are that is. And if the rights are fully allocated to the existing shareholders, we have that understanding with Norfund to come in through a private placement where there will be a 10% premium on the rights price at 82.50 rupees. They have the ability to go up to 9.99% of the bank's total equity, so which will also bring in another 3 billion. So all in all, 11 billion total capital raising, in which case NDB's total capital adequacy ratio in the tier 1 core capital will go up to 11.7% and total capital to 16.7%. So that if when you compare that with the peer banks, tier 1 and tier 2, which is around tier 1 around 13, between 11 to 13 kind of, and tier 2 around 14 to 16. So when you compare that, I think with the capital raising, we would be very much there, equal with the peer banks, and that is the one that has been addressed. The key dates for the rights issue, basically the general meeting and the EGM on 9th of April. So that is next week Friday. And XR date of 12th of April, the dispatching the letters of provisional allotments and all 20th April. And commencing of trading of rights, we're expecting by 27th April. With the renunciations and all completed, last date of acceptance and payment would be 5th of May. So by first week of May, we would have the rights issue and the private placement completed, so that funds would be available for the banks to continue on our growth trajectory. Now, this is where we have signed a key investor agreement, which was announced a couple of weeks back, where Norfund, which is the Norwegian government's investment firm for the developing countries, with a total capital investment of around $2.9 billion. This as at December 2019. Committed, having done quite a lengthy due diligence, commercial due diligence, credit due diligence, all done by outside parties, including external, different external set of auditors. And having completed that assessment with the credit approval and all, we signed an agreement for Norfund to come in as a shareholder, initially through the rights issue, where they will have the right to subscribe to all the unsubscribed rights up to a cap of 9.99%. But in case that figure is not fulfilled, they can come in to acquire further shares up to a total cap of 9.99%. So whatever the shortfall, through a private placement at a premium of 10% to the rights price, which is at 82.50 rupees. So it can go up to a maximum investment of, in rupee terms, about 3.1 billion rupees. So this is quite a big announcement, and Norfund, this is the first equity investment in Sri Lanka for Norfund. And at a time that country is also looking for private investment, this is quite a good initiative. And I think not only Norfund coming in as an equity partner, shareholder, naturally they have the funding arrangement, the technical assistance and all, which are coming, because Norfund is a long-term investor. And NDB is quite privileged to welcome institutional investor, a DFI, who has growth agendas like similar to ours in upskilling the country's SME sector, the women sector, where we have a lot of good stories to share with, and improving the country's profile. And Norfund and NDB's objectives are similar. And it's a good opportunity for us to tie up with Norfund and coming in as equity partner here. So this is a slide on how the NDB share Price has performed since last year. So it was a bit of high rate, about 100 range in February, March. But since the breakup of COVID, the price, like all the other shares, have come down. And now we are averaging somewhere around the private placement price, slightly above, now around 80-50, a bit higher than the rights price, but below the private placement price. So the private placement price is in blue line, and then the rights price in red. So I think we have been trading somewhere there, except for in January and February, where the market had unusual increases, which has now been corrected. So I think we are very, very much within that range of the rights price between and the private placement price. Net asset value per share as of December is 206.23 rupees. So the rights are coming at a quite attractive rate. So that's a message to the investor. On the rights issue, I'm sure you may have questions about what are we doing with the capital that we are raising. So as I mentioned, we are looking at the organic growth, where we have come with a five-year strategy, which was launched in the fourth quarter of 2020, which is for 5 years. In 2017, late 2017, we launched our Transformation 2020 strategy, which was a three-year strategy up to 2020, how we transform the bank in terms of size and also the liability focus and all. So once having achieved all those 2020 goals, much earlier, we came up with a five-year strategy. So in devising the strategy also, we looked at the platform that we have built, the caliber of our staff, the opportunities in the market, and also we looked at the policy clarity, which is available for the next 5 years with political stability and policies being clear for the next 5 years. So that was the reason for coming up with a five-year strategy, where one of the key strategic goals is to have our asset base crossing 1 trillion rupees, where we still believe the scale has advantage. But more than that, I think we have been focusing more on customers. The only differentiation among many banks is how customer-centric you are. And that's where our key layer is the customer centricity. Looking at rather than customer service, of course, we have been working very hard to get our customer service up, which is, I think, at quite optimum level. Now we are looking at how we can provide more customer-centric solutions. So different customers may have different needs, which are getting addressed in our strategy, how the different business verticals, how the business support functions can work together to get the optimum experience and provide the service, plus all the needs being covered. Now this is where NDB, various business verticals can work together, look at customer pain points, identify those gaps, and provide holistic solution using NDB's resources, the digital platforms, etc. Apart from that, we are in a unique position to make use of our subsidiaries in various financial sectors like the investment banking, stockbroking, or the wealth management, or even for that matter, even the NDB Zephyr Capital, who can take up some of the capital investments. So provide holistic solution using all these tools available, plus our operations in Bangladesh. All that can come in to provide a holistic solution through the customer-centric approach. So that is one of the key pillars undermining the Voyage 2025 strategy. In that, we have several pillars. Digital is one of the key pillars, and we have invested on digital layers. We are going for a core banking upgrade It should be ready by August, September this year. Along with that, investment in a digital platform. I think we are the only bank who have invested in a key digital platform. Right now, we are going through the digital journeys that we want to ensure that will be delivered. Plus, a lot of effort to ensure digitalizing the processes side. Now, that's where our bank has made quite a good headway in having all our transactions more carried through the digital platforms. So I'm quite happy to share that right now, more than 80% of bank transactions are done through digital channels. And that is something that we have been clearly driving. And also staff, one of the key strengths of NDB is quite a professional, quite a well-motivated staff. So getting the best out from them and giving best to them, ensuring this is a nice place to work. So that is the one other aspect that we are working on. And also to ensure that customer centricity is provided, we have also introduced certain metric structures to different areas so that all can work together to provide a holistic solution. So these are some of the key strategic pillars that will drive our strategy for next 5 years. And this is just to share some of the product portfolio that we have been growing. And you'd be pleased to note that in the personal banking side that we have quite a good set of market leaders. For example, NDB Dreammaker personal loans, I think we have the largest portfolio there. We are the only bank with a large sales force to go to the customer's doorstep and customize their requirements and then provide these loan solutions within a very short period. And this is a team, apart from the sales, they are a very good central credit team. We've been assessing this and working very hard to ensure that these personal loans are booked. NDB Good Life Card has made quite a good headway, quite a good growth story. I would say with the offers and all, the best card available at the moment. NDB Leasing, then the Aralia Women proposition. Now that's again, that's where we have invested in getting women customers to come to a branch which is much more welcoming, give them the opportunity to be at the IEs, have different loan schemes for them. I mean, market studies have shown their repayment ability is much better than the male customers. So we have devised a scorecard-based lending proposition for them, which is driven through Aralia. And recently, we tied up with the Vanita Mibani Award Scheme, again, to ensure this message is taken across to the women, where only 30-35% of the contribution to the economy is provided by the women, whereas our women population is 50-51%. So I think that is part of our responsibility also to get them up, have them a platform to showcase their talents, the products and all, and that is done through the women proposition. Wholesale banking and project financing, again, I would say we are doing very well in terms of project financing. I think we have the best expertise in funding the renewable energy projects. Over the last 4 years, Sri Lanka's total renewable energy project financing, NDB has contributed 30% of that. So that speaks a key message, how our project financing is good at assisting them, even assisting these clients to get who's getting into a solar, wind power, waste to energy or hydro. And that is in line with Sri Lanka's growth strategy as well. I think recently the roadmap also we are talking about getting the renewable energy power contribution to the national grid to make it around 70% from where it is today. We have now around 20% of our energy requirements are done through renewable energy. And the government's goal is to get it up to 70% in 5 years, which goes very well with our expertise in project funding side. And we have also funded some of the Sri Lankans who move into the African subcontinent and some of the other countries in the renewable energy side, using our expertise, and we are doing quite well there. In terms of corporate banking, the commercial banking, again, a very strong platform that we have built up, a very strong transactional banking platform, the cash management, which would go into a different level with the core banking coming in from September onwards. There again, as part of this acquired account from the ABN AMRO, there is a set of good corporate clients tail that we have been building, and that has helped as a quite a good platform for us to grow, and that's where we are making quite a good headway. We also have a separate Chinese desk to provide solution to growing Chinese clientele as well. The business banking or the SME side, this is a new vertical that we started in 2018, and that has basically progressed very well to contribute about 24% of the total bank's lending book on SME. And we also provide a lot of advisory services. All the credit officers from the bank are very well trained. I mean, that's the advantage of having a development bank heritage, where they have been very well trained in terms of credit assessment, underwriting standards, and also holding projects till it comes to a maturity level. And that expertise in being used using this SME platform. And we were the soon after the COVID also, we were the first to come up with a product for SME clients to display their products, the Jayagamu product. Again, we saw there's a need for a bank to come and help these SMEs to showcase their products. So that's why we tied up with two platforms, Daraz and Co365, to locally market their products and also export their products through a platform. And that platform is doing quite well. So these are the key product portfolios. Not to mention our quite active involvement in the treasury and the asset management side, but in terms of the business, other business verticals, we have made some good headway in all three fronts. And when it comes to the retail side, we have segmented the market, and there again, the privilege banking, NDB Privilege and the Privilege Select. And again, we have the largest private banking or the privilege banking portfolio in the country, served through a dedicated center plus several privilege centers in some of the key branches, providing tailor-made solutions to these clients. And again, in the strategy, we have a proper customer segmentation to provide more opportunities and also to have their loyalty with the bank. And that we have done quite well in growing this book with a very loyal customer base, and we are quite grateful to those customers. I'm sure some of them are even in this call for being with us and growing with us. And NDB Treasury, again, one of the key functions, frontline. I've been quite active in the market. They are one of the few market makers in foreign exchange and debt market and very active trading. A book that we have and plays a very vital role in managing the market risk. A very strong ALCO to ensure that our margins are kept, always keep on challenging the business as well to ensure that we keep the best for the benefit of the bank. And very highly skilled and experienced treasury team, which we are going to make use of them in growing our more trade volumes, more exchange volumes. So there is a, in the new strategy, part of the treasury team would be dedicated to go out and market treasury products along with the corporate RMs. And that is a key area that we are quite keen to grow more based on this strong platform that our treasury is having. SME, again, business banking, as I mentioned, the Jayagamu product was one of the key one that we came up tying up with. Chamber of Commerce, Export Development Board, the Maersk, the shipping line, then the insurance providers to have a holistic one-stop shop for them to promote the exporters and innovators. We also have strategic partnerships with various partners to support these business, some of these new businesses to get into the next level, they need a lot of legal advice, incorporating new corporate company, incorporation and all. Either in-house or there are a set of volunteers who are also working with us to provide that solution. And that is offered through the Jayagamu product, which is doing quite well to ensure that we do well in this sector. Now, these are the strategic partnerships that I mentioned, the Darashtra with the online platform, Merch Shipping Line to support exporters. They have been sharing their customer base also, the shipping lines. Then iLoan Lanka, again, the last mile financing that we have basically ventured into, and that is growing quite well, getting some good granular customer base as well. And then TQ and EDB, giving cloud technology and also enterprise service ERP resource planning side to provide ERP solution for the SME, so the bank would also have quite a good insights about the level of stocks, the debtors and all. That would help us to take some good credit decisions without purely relying on the financials. Those have also worked well to grow this business banking proposition. This is one slide on the NDB group structure and how the bank has basically having the capital market activities. So investment banking, we are the market leader. Wealth management, again, largest private sector asset management company. Right now, more than 180 billion worth of funds under management. Leading investment bank in Bangladesh, NDB that is NDB Capital Bangladesh. Then NDB Security, one of the pioneering and leading stockbrokers in Sri Lanka. And NDB Zephyr, I think that's the largest country-focused private equity fund now operating in Sri Lanka. So all these all offered through NDB Bank. So any investment in NDB would also, in the shares of NDB, would have the benefit of all these subsidiaries providing holistic solutions and support to the customers. So the benefit is accruing to the bank. And I think this is, I briefly touch on that, so I don't want to spend more time on that, leaving more room for the question and answer. So this is on banking on women. And in the digital, I think we'll spend some time on this because that's a key focus for us as well. So the NDB NEOS is making quite a good headway. For the month of March alone, as of yesterday, more than 8.5 billion rupees worth of transactions routed through NDB NEOS. 1 month. A couple of days back, we had 1 day where we had 500 million worth of, 502 billion worth of transactions done within 1 day using the NDB NEOS app. So that's the digital platform that we are talking about, which is a very user-friendly with interoperability, all in the wallet and the digital platform, all in one app. And that was an investment that we made about 1.5 years ago. Especially after the COVID, we have seen more than 500% growth in transaction volumes, and we are seeing quite a good growth in that. So NEOS Pay is one other thing. Then we have a couple of digital branches, NDB NEOS digital branches, two in one in Fort, just opposite World Trade Center, and the other in Shangri-La Mall. Then we have several bank to you branchless banking proposition, almost 100 branchless banking arrangements, and more than 50 cash recycling machines as other digitalized channels. And so that is one key area that we are focusing, and we have made quite a good progress on QR-based payments as well, with the cards, the credit cards also moving into a new platform, which we are completing that platform change, and with the acquiring coming in, would have a better opportunity using the digital platform to grow in that one. Again, this is something that I mentioned earlier in my earlier slides, technology as enabler. So first Sri Lankan bank to have digital workforce working hand in hand with the human workforce. So we have 15 RPAs already deployed, several workflow solutions, more than 12 workflow solutions to streamline many processes and also the core banking upgrade that we mentioned. So we'll be going for Temenos version 20, the latest version available by August, September this year. And this is, I mentioned about the gender diversity, which is highlighted by the EDGE certification. So 39% female representation from all staff, almost 40%. 7 out of our 19 leadership team members are ladies. We have 2 female board directors and flexi working hours, all that to ensure that we have a very diversified, gender diversified workforce with equal opportunities given for them to progress in their career. And on the corporate sustainability and environment side, again, very key area that bank is focusing on. So you would have noted that I think early this week, we were awarded as one of the top 10 corporate citizens in Sri Lanka by Chamber of Commerce, Sri Lanka Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. And this is an area that we are paying a lot of attention, the 3 pillars of entrepreneurship, environment, education. We have been investing on reforestation, home gardening under NDB Let's Grow concept, again, providing English education, English teacher training program with British Council. So much of, apart from the profit element, that we have been working with our staff to ensure that sustainable banking is given to the society. So a lot of employee volunteerism that we encourage in the climate change mitigation, pollution control, the reforestation. A few months back, we went and started 9.5 hectares in reforestation. I think we'll be investing a further 9.5 hectares this year. Then the Pitavala Patana, the again cleaning it up and providing that as a nice environment for the society to have a look and enjoy the beauty of the country. So many things to ensure that the environment is looked at. And then contributing to the other banking product like the NDB Aralia, the Vanita Abhimana, the Women's Appreciation Program, the Bank to You, where we are taking the bank to the, it's like the doorstep banking and taking the banking to the unbanks. There are various village level vendors, even we have several trishaw drivers saving with us every evening. Quite a sizable savings that they're making, thanks to the Bank to You platform. So this is not only a bank for big people, but we are a bank for everyone. So where we go and get them to come and invest with us using the Bank to You platform. And that has worked very well to have a broader customer base. And that is developing the backbone of the Sri Lankan economy. So these are key things under the environmental and social governance side, which is one of the key pillars, which is governed through the board level itself. So where we have a strong emphasis on that. I think these are the slides that are available, prepared for today's presentation. And now I leave it open for any question and answers. We have selected a few to give answers if there's anything apart from the coming in. So we have head of finance, head of strategy, 2 from NDB Capital and NDB Investment Banking, and also the head of business banking with me, and also head of treasury to take whatever questions we have. So time for questions. You can post your questions. We will read those questions, right? On the chat option, and then we would be happy to provide answers. Do you have any questions or? We are yet to receive any questions, so. There's one question that will you be going for tier two infusion post rights? Of course, we have certain tier two debentures and all which are maturing. Of course, that naturally we will replace them. But we also want to maintain some optimum capital level rather than unnecessarily going and raising. With the current low interest scenario, we may look for replacement of some of the tier two level bonds. But other than that, I think there is no need for us to go for further tier two level fundraising at extra cost. Because I think the capital that we are raising would be adequate to cover next 4 to 5 years growth. And I think when we plan the numbers, also we ensure that I think there's no need for us to go and tap the market again. There was another follow-on question. Will you not want to lock in low rates through debentures? Yeah, I did. I partly explained that. Yes, sir. We will look at that. We don't want to go and unnecessarily go and book more. But replacing some of the existing debentures, certainly we'll do. There are opportunities for some private unlisted debentures as well. We are working on bilateral basis with some of the investors. But unnecessary going and locking, yes, rates are low, appeal is there, but we'll assess the situation and then if there's a need, we will work on that rather than going and raising further debts. Last question, is there any particular reason NDB's NIM is lower than its peer? I think that is what I explained, that we have been addressing that and then we are narrowing the gap between the peer NIM and us. So we are at 3.1% and the peers may be around 3.3%. One key reason what I mentioned was that as a commercial bank, we are 15 years old and we are talking about some of the peers who have been in the industry for more than 30 or some more than 78 years. So, and then the branch network, if you look at it, 200 plus branches, ours is 113. But I think going forward, it is not the branch physical presence. It's more on a digital story. And that has worked well. And that has worked well to ensure our CASA rate has gone up. If you look at last year's deposits, 52% has come from as CASA. And right now, there's hardly any difference in terms of pricing between CASA and a deposit rate as well. But all in all, I think that is something we have been addressing. Apart from NIM, they have been addressing the fee income as well. So both these should address, rather than only looking at interest as a base. When the interest rates are lowered, I mean, we are now getting adjusted to lower single-digit interest rates in the market, the AWPLR or AWPLR minus lending that we are talking. So I think no longer it's only the interest or the NIM going to play a role. It's other income. The return on risk-weighted assets, how do you measure that? So it's not only the interest, but other income, total holistic solution. That is what is addressed in the customer-centric approach as well. How you tie up these clients and how you get the total income, the wallet share, rather than only working on the interest. And that would make sure that the long-term relationships are further developed and they will take the customer also to have a long-term relationship with the bank, rather than only concentrating on the interest margin. Any plans for tier one debenture issues? I think right now with the capital coming in, there is no need for us to think of a tier one debenture issue. Any other question? So it seems that there's no other questions. Shall we close? Okay, so my team wants to give it a couple of more minutes. Okay. There's one question on, will no fund get a board seat if the investment is successful? Yes, I think that is the understanding that we have. Provided their investment is successful, they would get a board seat. And I think apart from that, I think there will be a lot of contribution coming from the NOR fund, apart from a board seat. So certainly, yes. Will this increase foreign appetite for NDB? Yeah, I think certainly with the no fund coming in and all, with the existing shareholding of foreign health companies, I think NDB might have about 20% of the holding held by foreign entities. And certainly that has increased the foreign appetite for NDB as well. Soon after the announcement of no funds arrangement to come in as a shareholder, we have a lot of favorable requests, queries coming from several other foreign lending organizations, the DFIs, in terms of funding. So that is quite a good advantage that NDB can work on, and that is good for the NDB customers and also for both fan as well. So the total foreign equity holding, I think currently we have about 11% shares held by foreign parties. That would go up to about 20% with no fund coming in. There's a question on how successful do you expect the rides to be? I think any percentage estimate and all. Yeah, I think we are quite comfortable. I did a preliminary inquiries with the key shareholders and all. After the announcement shows, all of them are quite quite happy to contribute. The only part that we can't check is the larger retail base. However, we are quite comfortable that we should be able to get quite a good response to the rights issue. Even if it's a price and all compared to the market price today, again, it's properly priced. Good appetite shown. And that's where the story about NDB, the growth story, that's what we thought that we should share with the investor community, where I'm sure you all have a lot of clients of yours. You can take the story to the existing shareholders and also the potential new shareholders to share this message, because it's a good share to invest in, good market value investments compared to the market value returns that you are getting. And even the investments that you have been planned also are supposed to give good returns. And it's a good story to share with your investor community. So I'm sure with that, we would be have a very successful rights issue that we are going to conclude. Okay. That's one question on that. Two questions. NDB share has been trading lower than book value for a while. When do you expect this to be? Dylan, do you want to take that one? It is from investment banking side, probably can answer that.
Yeah, so I think the overall market itself has seen this phenomenon, which is common across the entire banking sector. I mean, if you really look at the reasons behind it, probably the sluggish credit growth that we had over the last several years with the monetary tightening, certain foreign exits in the market may have led to an excess supply of shares, which depressed prices. But with private credit growth picking up and the overall macro economy also getting back into growth mode, we expect this gap or the discount from net asset value to reduce over a period of time. Of course, when and how that would happen would be anyone's guess, but clearly the indicators are positive, and we hope that this gap would be bridged very much in the near future than the distant future.
Thanks. There's one.
Can I add one thing?
Yes, so this is Senaka. Come, come.
Yeah. So let me add one piece to that question. I think historically, one main reason for the trading at below the book was there was a larger taxation for the banking sector, which got reversed in a recent budget. And also the high interest rate prevailed in the country. I think on both those parameters, I think we are seeing a positive movement. Unfortunately, I think due to COVID and the moratorium effects, there's a bit of a hangover in the sector. But I think once that clears, I think it should soon pick up with the book value in our view.
Thank you. There's one more question on, can you give some direction to possible provision reversals in 2021? And also, what areas will NDB treat as midterm priorities? Okay, so the first one is about direction about possible provision releases, reversals. I think with the economy picking up, we should be able to work on that. I think last year, you would note even last quarter of financial year, our impairments were slightly higher than the rest of the other three quarters, mainly due to the model adjustments and also the economic effect adjustment, where country had a negative growth rate. But the growth rate expected to be a positive, at least 3.5-4% minimum. The economic factor adjustment should be more favorable to the bank, and that can have certain provision releases. apart from that, there were certain interest provisions made to support those customers under moratorium with 7% interest. I mean, that also more policy clarity, central bank providing, and based on the customer request for these things, I think there again, there'll be some headroom for us to release some provisions. So those are the key areas where additional provision made last year might get released. But apart from that, I think economy signs of recovery when you see this. Now, you'd have seen the credit growth, the private sector credit growth for month of February is going up. We see that even in March, quite a good credit appetite also shown. So that could also help the economic activity, except for the tourism sector. We see all the other sectors now getting back to the normalcy. So that would also help to get us some of those accounts got stuck. Even those under moratorium also, we have done a very critical assessment there again. I think that those who can come out from the moratorium would be over from today, except for those under tourism. Again, most of them have the ability to bounce back. So those will help to get more credit and the provision releases coming in this year. And also, there was the other question was what area the NDB will treat as midterm priorities. So midterm, naturally, as I showed, the pie chart is quite a good credit story. So we'll be focusing on all those. But SME sector can be one that can, like that they got the worst affected was also SME. But when it comes to bouncing back, again, it would be the backbone, the SME who can bounce back soon. So we will be very supportive of that sector to help them to come out. That is where we have come up with various products like the Jayagamu Sri Lanka product or the women's women-driven businesses. That's where NDB has the caliber to identify the right one, nurture them, help them in their difficulties and support their growth. So that is something that we can prioritize as well while the retail corporate, they are giving our bread and butter. So now, again, time for us to go and help some of these SMEs and support them to go, because that's part of our responsibility as well to get the country's economy have a jump start. NDB has made reference to potential inorganic growth. Any updates or development in this line? I think it's too early for us to share publicly about the inorganic growth plans, but naturally, when a bank is growing, when there's capital, and when there's a quite efficient management team also to support, we are hungry for business. So there'll be inorganic opportunity that would come our way. We would certainly look at them, but it's too early for us to discuss in detail. There's a question on what percent of the NDB book is under moratorium. I think we shared that earlier as well in our annual report. Initially, last year, somewhere in April, when the moratoriums were introduced, it was roughly about 40%, which came down to about 25% of the book. I think as of now, it would come further down after the moratoriums are released. I would expect maybe around 10% of those would have certain challenges. Maybe this includes some of them in the tourism sector, or even less than 10, maybe 8%. And we have done a critical assessment and we are comfortable that we should be able to manage with a very low level of customers in the moratorium from tomorrow onwards. Shall we? And it looks like those are the questions that we have received so far. So thank you very much for being with us, and thank you for attending this session. And we encourage you all also to study more about the bank. We have a few weeks more. So take this message across to your clients, institutional clients, even the retail clients, because this is a good share to invest in. So we're looking forward to your support to also share this and ensure that our rights issue is a success. We are comfortable, but we are also comfortable that you'll have a nice story to share with among your clients so that we can have a good rights issue. This is the first rights issue for the year as well. So to make it close in a high note. Thank you very much.